Good morning, Harvest.
Good morning.
Great to see you this morning. So glad you've come to church. We have a great start already worshiping our great Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. That's what we do here. We also open up God's Word. We're going to do that today. Thanks for coming and leaning in. Get your Bibles. You can open to Mark chapter 3. We're going to be in verses 7 through 19. As many of you know, Chris and I have 5 kids. And as you might imagine, when we had 5 kids 10 years of age and younger, our house was kind of a free-for-all. We always seemed like 24/7 we're dealing with different issues, of course. And just Chris and I just trying to love and just do life together by God's grace, you know, parenting on the fly. But God is super gracious. And there's certain times, though, where I would sense from the Lord that He was giving me special opportunity with one of my kids to speak into them, to help them really learn something really important, to instruct them, and really help build their character. Special sense that this is something really like that. And when I would get those feelings, it always would involve a heart-to-heart, quiet, kind of calm conversation. And when I did that, I always would call the son or Caitlin to me, and I would say, "Brian, come here. Sit down here on the couch right next to me. Let me put my arm around you." Or, "Caitlin, come over here. Lay on the bed. We need to talk." Call them close, because there's something I really wanted to get to them. There's something about proximity that allows for love to have its full effect. There's something about proximity for love to have its full effect. And Jesus is calling us to come because He wants His love to have full effect. And so the title of the message today in our Just Jesus series is really simple. It's called Come Close. And I'm praying, have been praying, that and hoping that the Lord would allow you to draw close, to come close to Him today. And we're going to look at 3 reasons why Jesus calls us to come close in Mark chapter 3. Verses 7 to 19, let me pray and we'll get into it. Father God, I thank You for the invitation, this amazing thing that the God of the universe would call me and call these people that have chosen to come to church today, the second service, to come close to You. It's an amazing, wonderful invitation. And God, I pray that we would desire the nearness of You. Your word says the nearness of my God is my good, and that You want us to come is such a blessing. So help us, God. Help us to hear from Your word now. Thank You for preserving it through the ages so we could open it and talk about it today. And we want it to affect our lives and affect our worship and faith in You. So have Your way in our hearts, I pray, in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. All right, title, Just Jesus, Come Close. Here's the first point. You can write it in the blank. Come close because Jesus wants to change you. Come close because Jesus wants to change you. Look at your Bibles at chapter 3. We're going to start in verse 7. Here it is. Jesus withdrew with His disciples to the sea, and a great crowd followed from Galilee and Judea and Jerusalem and Idumea and from beyond the Jordan and from around Tyre and Sidon. All right? So what do we see here? Well, we've been seeing in Mark chapters 1 through 3 two things significantly growing. Kind of the theme of the first 3 verses, as well as Jesus' authority, is this. Two things are growing. Number one, what we're seeing is there's growing opposition to Jesus. All right, scribes, Pharisees, there's this growing opposition to what Jesus is doing. The second thing we're seeing in these first 3 chapters is that Jesus' fame is growing and the crowds are becoming large. And that's what we're seeing here, beginning in verse 7, is that the crowds are growing. Look at it. Jesus withdrew with his disciples to the sea. He just healed the man with the withered hand. The Pharisees kind of were giving him a rough time about it. Now he withdraws. But a great crowd followed from Galilee, Judea, Jerusalem, Idumea, from beyond the Jordan, from around the Tyre and Sidon. Really amazing what's happening now. People are coming from hundreds of miles to see Jesus. Why is this happening? There's no social media. There's no CNN. There's no newspapers. How is this happening? Well, it's happening because word travels what? Word travels fast. People are talking about it. They're simply sharing what Jesus is doing. People are talking and saying, this Jesus, he claims to be from God, and they're saying two things about him. The word is spreading. Number one, it's spreading because Jesus is doing amazing miracles. He's healing lepers. He's healing a guy with a withered hand. He takes a paralytic and makes him walk. Demons are being cast out, and the word is spreading. But the other thing that's spreading is that Jesus is teaching in a new and a powerful way. And the Bible says, as one who has authority. And the word's out that the scribes and the Pharisees don't even know how to handle this amazing teaching. And people are being moved. And they're willing to share what's happening with others. And because of that, people are flocking to Jesus. Are you sharing what Jesus is doing? Is the authority of God's word teaching you or changing you? Is God doing a miracle in your life and changing something that you couldn't believe? Is he doing something? If he is, and I hope that he is, are you sharing it? Are you sharing it? Is he moving in your church? Who have you told? It's amazing. Look down again, verse 8, and Jerusalem, Idumea. Let me just show you a map real quickly. This is the map. So Jesus is up in Galilee. Capernaum is way at the north of the Sea of Galilee up there. You can see the little dot. Now these people are coming from all over. Idumea is way down below Jerusalem. Tyre and Sidon are to the right of the Jordan River, where it says Perea, and it gets out that direction. They're flocking to Jesus Christ, and they're coming from so far. We asked someone to do the geography of how far they were coming. They were coming in an area of 13,000 square miles. People were coming to Jesus at these dates. Well, obviously, these places are true. All right? 13,000 square miles. Let me give you like a kind of a point of reference. That's basically like from Peoria to the Indiana border all the way up Indiana to Crystal Lake. That's how far people are coming. And they just didn't get in their Chevrolets. They walked. It's amazing what's happening here. Look at down there. It says in the end of verse 8, when the great crowd heard all that he was doing, they came to him. They came to him. What happens when people hear about Jesus? What happens when people hear about Jesus? They say the word starts with a C. They come. What do? They come. When they hear about Jesus, they come. Whether for their, well, let me just do it. Mike, hey man, what's up? How are you? Good to see you. I got to tell you something, Mike. My sister just got back from Capernaum. And she was up there, and there was this guy that said he was a man of God, and there were people flocking to him. He touched a guy with leprosy, and he was completely made well. Unbelievable. I was in this house, and dudes like came. They lowered this guy down to the ceiling, and he was a paralyzed guy, and Jesus healed him. And then he talked about forgiveness. And then he got in it with the scribes and the Pharisees, and this man, my sister said, the way that he talked was something we've never heard, and it's with power and authority. I'm telling you, dude. It's unbelievable. Have you heard anything about it? Did you hear about it? We just heard it now. Okay. Hey, I'm going up. I'm going to go up. We're down here in Jerusalem, but I'm going up because, man, last night I was at the corn maze, and I was walking in the dark in the corn maze, and I went under this bridge, and you know I got MS, and I stepped over this board, and I couldn't get my left leg up, and I hit the board, and I fell like 6 feet forward right into a 4x4, and that's why I got this problem with my eye. I don't know if you guys all can see it, but man, it made me remember that I got MS, and I'm going, because I think maybe, Jesus, if I can just get to him, maybe I could be healed. And I'm sure you got something in your life you'd love him to change, right? Hey, we got to go. You want to go?
Absolutely.
All right. It's going to be tough. I limp, but it's going to be a long walk, dude. And you got some cash because we're going to have to get a split hotel or something? All right. Yeah, your wife will fund it. All right, good. All right. We're going. We're going now. You're not going to watch the Bear game. We're going now. This is what happened. That is not unlike what exactly happened, except for the bears and the corn maze part. But that's actually true. If you look at my face today, I got a big old black eye. But I just got to get to Jesus. He can change me. He wants to change me. That's the point. Come close because Jesus wants to change me. But the reality is, do you want to be changed? Sounds easy to answer. Yes, of course. But how badly do you want to be changed? Because coming to Jesus doesn't come without a cost. Mike and I are going to have to forego the Bear game. We're going to have to get some cash. I'm going to have to walk 2 days' journey with my limp MS to get to Jesus. It's going to cost me something. Plus, I have a job. I'm going to leave my job, and we are going to go to, it's going to cost me something. So I know you want to be changed, but do you really realize there might be some cost? Here's the cost of coming to Jesus. I just got 5 things. When you really come to Jesus, there's going to be some cost, and here's one of the first things. It's relationships. How many of you, when you came to Jesus, a relationship in your life had more tension all of a sudden? Because when you came to Christ, raise your hand, maybe in your family or a friend, I want to high. I want to see high. Look around, people. There's something, when you come to Jesus, there's a cost. I'm not saying you're still not friends with them. I'm not saying, obviously, they're still family members. But it's different. There's something because you made a commitment to Jesus. Here's a second thing. It costs you your desires. It costs you to desires. Before you know Jesus, you're all about pleasing who? Yourself. The Bible talks about that's the desires of the flesh. And we still fight them. But when you come to Jesus, the word says that you put to death those. We don't always do it, but we have power to do it. And so some of those things for myself that I was pursuing, they're gone. They got to be gone. Increasingly more. Here's a third thing. Cost of following Jesus. It's time. The Bible says that you were bought with a price and your life is no longer your own. And the breath that you got this morning was given to you and you are entrusted with the opportunity to keep breathing and to keep living. You are God's instrument now. And so time, you're going to have to make some sacrifices now that aren't just for what you want to do, but what Jesus calls you to do. There is a cost with serving. There is a cost with following Jesus. You could do a lot of things with your time, but now I'm going to choose to do this with my time. There were 50-some people here this morning at 8:30 that are serving you, whether it's in the children's ministry or in the parking lot or ushers or whatever. They sacrificed to get here early to pray for you and then to go serve today. They could have done a lot. They could have slept in longer. They could have went out for breakfast with their spouse. But they chose to give their time. There's a cost. Here's another thing. Costs for coming to Jesus. Money. Before you knew Jesus, you had 10% more money in your bank account. But God says that if you love me, you're not going to put money before me, and I would like 10% of what you make. Not because I need it, but because you need to give it so your heart's in the right place. So give with a generous heart, give sacrificially give 10%. There's a cost to following, a cost to come to Jesus. And here's the last thing, and this is kind of a funny one because it really isn't even true, is your cost is the control of your life. But you never, just so you know, you never ever had control of it. But we think we do before we come to Jesus, but I'm just telling you, you don't. But for sure, when you come to Jesus, you have no more control. You have no idea what God's going to choose to do, but you know if you love him, he's going to do something good in you. But he is now in control and not you. There's a cost to following Jesus. How far are you willing to go to come to Jesus? Look back down at the scripture. Let's look at verse 9. And he told his disciples to have a boat ready for him because of the crowd, lest they crush him. For he had healed many so that all who had diseases pressed around him to touch him. Let's just like set the scene here. Jesus is healing people and he's teaching and people are like flocking to him. Thousands now people are coming and following around. He wants to go. You can see it in verse 7. He wants to go, but the people are following him. Thousands of people, and they're crushing into him, just like me. I got an MS. If I can just get to Jesus. Mike, make a way. Knock the people down. Get me to Jesus, because if I can touch him, my MS might be gone. That's one. Multiply that by 5,000 people that want to get to Jesus Christ. They don't even know why yet. They don't know who he really is. They just know that he could change them. Can you see the scene? The disciples are really not really like learners, which the name disciple means. They're actually probably more like security guards at this stage. They're just trying to keep people away from Jesus because he's going to get crushed. And Jesus sees it and knows it. Look what he says. And he told the disciples to have a boat ready for him because of the crowd, lest they crush him. For he had needed to see it, the boat ready. Get the boat ready because I'm going in. I'm going to have to get out at some point, but I'm going in the masses. He doesn't want to go away. He moves in. Jesus wants to change you. Jesus is ready, willing, and able to change us. He's not overwhelmed. He's not too busy. He's not annoyed. He's not discouraged that you're coming. He's not too weak to heal you. He wants to change you. He says, come close because I want to change you. His love says, I'm willing. And his power says, I'm able. Just come close. Just come close. God is working in your life when you come close to him. And at the perfect time and in the perfect way, for your good and his glory, your trial is going to be over. Your hurt is going to be healed. And your stronghold is going to be broken. I want to say that one more time because I worked a lot on that sentence. But it's a good one. And it's truth, people. God is working in your life when you come close to him at the perfect time and in the perfect way for your good and his glory. Your trial is going to be over. Your hurt is going to be healed. And your stronghold is going to be broken. Why? Because when you come close, Jesus wants to change you. That's our first point. Here's our second point. Come close because Jesus wants a relationship with you. As good as it is that he wants to change you, I think this point is even better. I think it's even better. Look at verse 13. Let's look at verse 13. No. We got to finish. We don't want to skip the verses. Look at verse 11 first. And whenever the unclean spirit saw him, they fell down before him and cried out, "You are the Son of God." And he strictly ordered them not to make him known. Here's the point here. Just to make sure you understand that he is able and has all power, Mark gives us this picture. Even the demons now are what? Falling down. See the scripture? They fell down. They are in submission to him. He has all authority. Understand that the Creator has authority over every single piece of creation. Over you, over the angels and demons, over nature, over every single thing that you see, not just see, but what's going to happen next. Everything that you can't see, he's over that and has authority. He has all authority because he has a name. And what's the name that the demons say? Look in the scripture. What's the name they say? Son of God. He is God of very God, and nothing can stand against him. Nothing. So you think your little piddly MS, you think your little problem, God has the power and authority to change you. And he will do it in his perfect way and in his perfect time. You have to trust him, but what you have to do most is you have to come close to him. Come close to him. Now, we can go to point number two, because I missed that in point number one. Point number two, come close because Jesus wants a relationship with you. Verse 13, and he went up on the mountain and called to him those whom he desired, and they came to him. And he appointed 12, whom he also named apostles, so that they might be with him. Wow, it just preaches itself. You hardly need me to say anything. But let's just look at it. So what's he do? He goes up on a mountain. We learn from Luke chapter 6, a parallel passage about this incident. Jesus goes up to the mountain and he prays all night. I'm guessing he's praying with the Father about who he's going to choose. And then he calls his disciples, not just the 12. We learn in Luke 6 that he called more disciples than just the 12. A group of disciples, the ones he desired, as it says in the scripture. And then out of the group that came to him that day, he chose 12 apostles, calls them apostles. First time you see apostles, which just means sent out ones. All right? Love this. He called them. Look at verse 13. He called, I underlined that, called to him those whom he desired. Underlined called, underlined desired, and then in 14, underlined appointed. He called, he desired, he appointed. It just shows his intentionality. The desire part shows his intimacy and desire for intimacy. And the appointed part shows his initiative. He's the initiator. But we're focusing right now on the intimacy part. Look at it in the text. He appoints them, the 12, whom he also named apostles, so that they might be with him. Jesus is saying, the reason I'm making you apostles, first thing, there's more to come, but first is, I just want you to be with me. It's unbelievable that Jesus is saying this. It shows us that Jesus desires community. It shows us that he desires companionship. He wants you to have a relationship with him. And he can't have a relationship with the crowds, can he? But he can develop a relationship with 12. And if he even take three out of those and even spend more time with Peter, James, and John, he wants a relationship with these guys. He wants to walk through life with them. I want you to put yourself in the apostles' shoes. They've been walking with Jesus and watching all this stuff happen in Capernaum and Galilee area. They're watching him do the miracles. They're watching him teach. Jesus has actually called some of them to be disciples, to follow him, so they're following him. They're not apostles yet. When Jesus tells Peter to follow me, that doesn't mean he was an apostle. It just means join the group. But now, Jesus gets the group together and says, there's 12 of you that are going to hang. And I want you to put yourself in the shoes that Jesus would call your name. They don't even really understand the fullness of who Jesus is, but they've been watching, and that Jesus would say, come near. We're going to eat together. We're going to walk together. We're going to sleep together. We're going to laugh together, and we're going to go through life together, just me and you 12 dudes. My goodness. It was unorthodox, because rabbinical thing at the time, you would walk around and look for a teacher, and I would find who I'd want to come under, and I would go ask the teacher, can I be under you? And the rabbi would say yes or no. But this isn't like that. It's the flip. It's completely unusual. It's flat out unbelievable that Jesus, the rabbi, would say, I want you. They must have been like, are you kidding me? You want me? I ask you to put yourselves in the apostle's shoes and what it would have felt like, because you are in his shoes. Jesus wants a relationship with you. He wants a relationship with you. And he calls you, and he desires you, and he's appointing you to come close. I, as mentioned last week when I did that little devotion before the offering about my past, I worked for the Gatorade company. I was in their sports marketing group. And I got to interact with different athletes. Some of you know this, Michael Jordan. One of the jobs I had was I would go to commercial shoots. And because I was in the sports marketing department, it was my job to make sure the athletes didn't get asked anything from the directors to do anything they didn't want. And my job was just to make sure everything would go well for them. So I would go with Michael on a commercial shoot, or Peyton Manning, or trying to think who all, just other, like our guys in Gatorade. And I went on a shoot with Peyton Manning. First time, we had a really good time, and we got to know each other. I was a quarterback in college, so we kind of hit it off. When we got back, about a month later, I got a call from Peyton Manning. What the heck? First of all, just I get a call from Peyton Manning. And he says, I want you to come down to Indianapolis. I want you to come down. We're going to go golfing. We're going to take you to my country club. Then we're going to go over to the house. I want you to meet Ashley. We're going to have dinner. And I just want you to come down and have some fun. Are you kidding me? Peyton Manning, you want me to come down and hang out with you? What is going on? I've won the lottery. That's absolutely child's play compared to the creator of the universe saying, I want you. I want you. As good as that is, forget it. I could leave that behind. Just knowing that Jesus wants me is all I need, is all I need. It's awesome. It's phenomenal. I don't want you to lose the awe of that if you know Jesus. And if you don't know Jesus, I want you to be hungry for it. Because it's awesome. It's awesome. Does it sometimes feel unbelievable that God has chosen you to walk with him? I kind of feel that. But right now, as we talk about this closeness with Jesus, you might be saying, how do I draw close? I really want to draw close. And I really don't know how. It sounds really great. But I want to give you some practical things now. How do you draw close? If you really believe that God wants you to draw close, how do you draw close? And here it is, three columns of closeness. First column is spirit. God has given you a spirit. That is that part of you that knows, that feels, that thinks, that cries inside, that part of you that only you know and only God knows. That's called your spirit. And you can relate to God and draw close to him in that realm in three ways. You do it through worship. We just did it. If your heart was calling out to God, you just weren't going through the motions of singing a song, your spirit is rising up to draw near, to get close, to come to Jesus in that worship moment. Secondly, prayer. The opportunity to talk to him is coming close to him. So the fervency and the frequency of your prayer is coming close to Jesus. And then thirdly, I don't do this enough, it's fasting. When I choose to say to myself, Nothing is more important than God, and I'm going to deny myself this to make sure I put nothing in front of Jesus. That's your spirit to his spirit, and you come close. Column one. Column two, you come close, you come to Jesus through interaction with his word. He's preserved his word for thousands of years so you can open it up and read it and be instructed and be encouraged, but mostly not to get from him, but to get with him. That's what the word of God is for. A quiet time isn't about getting something out of it, though you do, because the word is filled with wisdom. But it's to get with him. It's to draw close to him. And you do it through reading and studying his word. You do it through meditating on his word. And you do it through memorizing his word. If you want to come close, you want to use the word of God, which is the tool. It's not flat. The word of God is a means to the living God. And then the third column is people. If you want to draw close to Jesus, God says you have to get with his people. And you do that in three ways. You serve them. When you serve the Lord, God empowers your service through his spirit. And he draws near to you and you come close to him, especially when you stretch. Secondly, you come through community. God doesn't want you to go through this life alone, so you get connected. You get a spiritual mentor. You get into a small group. You do not do life alone. If you are coming here just on Sundays to worship, you are missing out completely on the third pillar, the third column. And then lastly, you draw close to Jesus when you witness. He gives you courage. He gives you strength. He gives you joy. He gives you intimacy when you share his good news. So this is the way, if you are saying today, I want to come close. This is the ways that God has provided. There's others, I'm sure. But these are the ones that I've identified. And these are the ones that I try to put in my life so I can have a real relationship with Jesus. Why? Because if we come close, Jesus wants a relationship with us. Last thing I say about this, we got to move to the next point. Look at the scripture again, the end of 14. Well, we'll go all the way through 14. And he appointed the 12, whom he also named the apostles, so that they might be with him. And he might send them out to preach and have authority to cast out demons. So it doesn't just end with me being with him. But I want you to understand that Jesus doesn't need you. He allows you the ability to go out and preach and to cast out demons and to work for him. But he doesn't need you. He wants you to, but he doesn't need you to. Does that make sense? He can do whatever he wants. He'll use the next person if he doesn't use you. But I want you to know that Jesus values you not because of what you do for him. He values you because he loves you. He's not like a bad boss that basically doesn't care about you, just only what you can do for him. He loves you and he draws you close and wants you near to him. And he wants you to come close so that he can empower you to go. But I'm telling you, he's not like a manipulative person that just wants you to get his job done. You can see it in the scripture. He says, first thing first, just come with me. Just come with me. That's practical for you that are in the business realm. If you have anybody who works for you, do you value them for who they are, or do you just value them for what they do for you? It's always about people. Jesus is always about people. Jesus is going to accomplish his ministry and his mission. But he's about the disciples, and he's about the people that the disciples are going to pour into. It's always about people. Yes, ministry and mission. But what is the ministry and mission? It's people. Jesus is awesome. That's why we're doing this Just Jesus series. If you want to know if this be with him thing was fruitful in the lives of the disciples, just write down Acts 4:13. Write it down. I'm not going to go into it now. But you'll see that Jesus caused them to just be with them and see what happened. All right. Review. Jesus wants us to come close because he wants to change you. Jesus says come close because Jesus wants to have a relationship with you. And lastly, come close to Jesus because Jesus wants to send you. Look at verse 16. Well, let's keep going in 14. So that he might be with them and he might send them out to preach and have authority to cast out demons. He appointed the 12, Simon, to whom he gave the name Peter, James the son of Zebedee, and John the brother of James, to whom he gave the name Boanerges, that is, sons of thunder, Andrew, Philip, Bartholomew, Matthew, and Thomas, and James the son of Alphaeus, and Thaddeus, and Simon the Canaan, and Judas Iscariot, who betrayed him. Jesus chooses the 12. What was so special about the 12? What was special about the 12? Nothing. Nothing. Tax collector. Blue-collar fisherman. A rebel. A doubter. Two hotheads. Boanerges, the sons of thunder, is like means that like they were hotheads. They were kind of like feisty dudes. Jesus, it wasn't about what they were bringing to the mission. He wasn't looking for the most talent. He wasn't looking for the most experience. He wasn't looking for the most well-respected. He wasn't looking for the most anything. I hope that encourages you. Jesus says, come just as you are. Just as you are. What were these guys? They were faithful men. They were available men. And they were teachable men. That's all he cares about. They're faithful, they're available, and they're teachable. God's got an appointment for you and a mission and a message. He wants to send you out. That's what he does. He gets them to be with them and that he might send them out. But he doesn't need anything from you. When I left the marketplace and I went into ministry, we started this thing called Competitors for Christ here in McHenry County. And it was just using sports to teach people about Jesus. I had absolutely no idea what I was doing. I left all that marketplace stuff and I had no idea, but I had a heart and I wanted to do something for God. And God did everything. Do you think that when the disciples went out to preach and when they cast out demons, that they did that on their own power? No. They did it through the power of Jesus. Jesus, through his Holy Spirit, gave them the words to speak. And Jesus, through his Holy Spirit, gave them the power to cast out demons. It had nothing to do with them except that they were willing to go. The gap between who I am and who I need to be is large, but Jesus fills the gap if I'm just willing to go. He wants to do that with you, but you just have to come. You just have to come. Where is he sending you? Is he sending you to Crystal Lake South High School as a student? Harvest Christian Academy? Prairie Ridge High School? Is he sending you to Glenbrook Road? Probably not, because that's my street. He sent me to Glenbrook Road. He sent you to Blank Street. I don't work at Motorola, and I don't work at Stryker, but I don't work at Starbucks, but you might. Does he have an appointment for you? What's the answer? Yes. He has an appointment for you. And he wants to send you out. Come close to Jesus and he will propel, provoke, prod, provide, and power you to go out for him. This is the point. The closer you come to Jesus, the more you want to go for Jesus. There's no other way. The closer you get to Jesus, the more you want to go for Jesus. So the answer isn't, oh my gosh, what am I supposed to do? God's going to show you and he'll give you the power. The answer is, come close and trust me, you're going out. You're going out. Last thing is this diagram. This kind of capsulizes the whole message. Being with Jesus, being in community, and being sent out. It doesn't really look like this in all of our lives. Our circles aren't all the same size. Some of us are really doing good in some things and not in the others. But the desire of God is that we would be humming in all three. And it's okay because we're all on a journey. All right? But the goal is obviously the center where we're doing it all in a way that is being empowered by... First of all, Jesus wouldn't ask us to do any of this if he didn't give us the strength, time, energy to do it. Don't ever think that I can't do all that the Bible asks me to do. If you can't do it, either you're trying to do it on your own strength or you're ignorant. You can do it. God's not asking you to do something you can't do. But the issue is sometimes, let's say we're not with Jesus. If we're not with Jesus very much, but we are in community in the church and we're being sent out, we're doing it without power. Some of us might be with Jesus and we might be in community, but we're sitting on our hands and doing absolutely nothing. Some of us are with Jesus and going for Jesus, but we're not in community with others until we have no accountability. God has designed the plan perfectly, and he's designed for you to be in all three circles in the sweet spot. But the bottom line of all of it is that Jesus wants you to come close. Just get to Jesus. Come close because he wants to change you. Come close because he wants a relationship with you. Come close because he wants to send you out. There are certain sermons, I believe, that I think every time God's word is preached, there's opportunity for significant change. But I believe sometimes there's crossroads. And I'm praying this potentially could be a crossroad message for you. Because if you come close to Jesus, if you just get Jesus, I'm telling you, everything else doesn't matter. He'll take care of everything. So what I want to do is we're going to open up the front. The band is going to play in a second a song. I'm going to ask you to stay seated for the first part of the song. Except if you're feeling convicted and desirous to come closer to Jesus, I want you to come forward. If you want to come close because you need something changed in your life, I want you to signify your desire to come close for that change by getting up out of your seat and coming up here and kneeling down and telling God, I'm coming close, God. And I'm trusting you that in your perfect way and in your perfect timing, you are going to change things because you're willing and able. You might come because you maybe wandered from Jesus or your time with him has been cut short or something's gotten in the way, and you want to come close because you want a fervent relationship with him. And you want to tell him, I'm coming, Jesus, I'm coming. Get up out of your seat in a second and come down and pray. Lastly, some of you might be saying, I really do want to go, but I'm either afraid or I don't know what to do. And Jesus is saying, just come to me. I'll show you. I'll give you the strength. I'll give you the power. So if that's you, like, where do I go, God? What do I do? Just come. Get close. So the band's going to play. Stay seated, but get up if you want to come. Come to the front. Then I'm going to pray. Then we're all going to stand and we're going to worship together. So come now.